This week, our castaway is the actress Helen Mirren. Helen, how much does music mean in your life?
My parents were both very musical. In fact, my father used to play the viola in a large London orchestra.
Did he?
In his very early days, yes, before he realised he couldn't keep a family on it. But I didn't inherit the musical bent of my father at all. I'm really pretty ignorant about music.
Do you sing?
Horribly, yes.
Have you had occasion to sing in the theatre?
Oh, yes, I have, yes. I learnt the meaning of the word bottle. And also I learned how that you can actually persuade an audience that you can do something that, in fact, you patently and obviously can't do, just by sheer force of your mind over theirs.
Yes.
And I can't sing at all, but I had to sing in a play called Teeth and Smiles.
Oh, yes.
The group that used to play behind me, it was a rock and roll group,
uh-huh.
used to say, "Come on, Ellen, now, don't lose your bottle." And I said, no, I'm not. I won't lose my bottle. Because
no.
The minute you lose your bottle, in other words, you lose your courage.
Yes.
And your kind of self-confidence.
Do you play discs a lot?
I do, from time to time. Very, very late at night, as I'm drifting off to sleep, is the time I like to actually listen to music.
Yes.
Otherwise, I use music really as a total kind of background, sort of, energizer. I really listen to basically a lot of rock and roll, although I don't have any rock and roll in my selection at all. And I think that's because I don't really listen to it.
What's the first one you've chosen?
Oh, the first one is Violin Concerto by Brooke, played here by Kung Wah Chung. I chose this because one of my earliest memories was my father practising his viola upstairs in the bedroom, and this was the piece of music he actually used to practise on his viola, although it is a violin piece, and it will remind me of my dear father, who's died just a year ago. So it's for him, really.
Right.
It's a piece.
Part of the Brooke First Violin Concerto with Kyung Wah Chung and the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra, conducted by Rudolf Kempe. Your father, in fact, was Russian, wasn't he?
Yes, he was born in Russia. We changed our name when I was about 13 or so. It was not easy to be an immigrant in England in those days. I'm sure it still isn't. But to be a foreigner with a sort of foreign accent was not an easy thing, and I think he wanted to become as English as possible. Mm.
What part of the country were you born in?
I was born in London, in Chiswick.
Yeah.
I was a record birth, in fact, in Chiswick. I
don't
know if it's
birth.
Been broken since. Apparently I came out in 20 minutes from beginning to end.
Oh, that's marvellous.
Yes.
And then you moved to Essex.
That's right, yes, we moved to Leigh-on-Sea in Essex.
And you were educated in a convent.
Yes.
Apart from lessons, what were your main interests at school?
Dreaming. I was a great dreamer and a fantasist. I liked drama at school.
Yeah.
We had quite a lot of drama at school, and I sort of hooked onto that at quite an early age, mainly because it was so easy for me.
Mm-hmm.
And also it sort of related to the dreaming and the fantasy part of my life.
You were very bright at school. I've got a note here that says 7 O-levels and 2 A's.
Well, that's not very bright, is it? One of my A-levels was art as well, though. You can't really count that, can you? And the other one was English, and you can't really count that. No, I did have 3 goes to get maths O-levels.
Mm.
I can't understand how I could have been so stupid in those days.
When you left school, what did you set about doing?
Well, I made the great mistake of going to a teacher's training college.
What did you want to teach?
I didn't want to teach anything. I absolutely hated school. I hated school even worse as a teacher than as a pupil.
Mm-hmm.
It was just something that my school thought I ought to do, and my parents thought I ought to do. I wanted to be an actress, but they both parents and school just thought that was impossible and ridiculous.
How old were you when you decided that you wanted to be an actress?
I think I was probably about 13 or 14.
Yes.
I mean, you don't really know. It's all so jumbled up with dreaming and fantasies. You don't know whether you're just being a silly dreamer, like everyone tells you you're being, or if it's a realistic thing.
So what did you do about it? Here you were in a teacher's training college, yes, wanting to be an actress.
I secretly applied for the National Youth Theatre, which a teacher at school told me about, because she was the only one really who gave me any sensible encouragement, and I think she kind of recognised that I possibly could do it. And she told me about the National Youth Theatre, and I secretly applied for it without telling my parents or anyone. Not because I thought they disapproved, but I'd be so embarrassed if I didn't get in. And I was accepted. And that was a wonderful thing for me, because it meant every summer holiday I went off and did plays as near to professional theatre as you could possibly imagine. We did it, one in the Queen's in Shaftesbury Avenue one season. The next season we did it at the Old Vic. In fact, I did Antony and Cleopatra in the Old Vic.
Yes, you played Cleopatra, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
And you played Helena in Midsummer Night's Dream.
That's right, yes. Yes. So, I mean, that was the most wonderful opportunity to actually find out what it was realistically like.
Let's break for your second record. What's that?
Oh, this is the present, really. And this is just to dance around to. It's good to have a dance around, get your energy and your spirits up. And this is such a lovely record called Pass the Duchy.
So I left my gate and went out for a walk.
Pass the Duchy by Musical Youth. So, Helen, there you were at the National Youth Theatre. What was your first professional engagement?
I can't actually remember. I think it was doing a play called Little Malcolm and His Struggle Against the Eunuchs, which I did for 1 week in Sunderland at, I think it was the Alhambra Theatre in Sunderland. And it's a huge theatre, vast, you know, one of those real barns. And I think we had about 50 people a night.
Oh, dear.
And one of my lines in the play was, "Will you shaft me?" And at this point, of those 50 people, at least 25 would get up. And they did have those seats that went, you know, back, back,
yes,
back.
Yes, back. Yes. Sounded like a round of applause.
Yeah, exactly. A rather distant round of applause. Yeah. So we used to regularly lose 25 of our audience of 50. And I think that was my first professional engagement.
Then you were in rep in Manchester.
Yes, then I went to rep in Manchester for
at the library?
About 6 months. No, I was at what is now actually the Royal Exchange, but it was the very, very early days of the Royal Exchange. And there was a very good company working at the University Theatre.
Yes.
Under Brer Murray, who now is running the Royal Exchange. So we did good work there.
And then quite soon, you were invited to join the Royal Shakespeare Company.
Yes, I think they'd seen me do Antony and Cleopatra, you see, and I was accepted.
What part did they give you?
The first year, I played Diana in All's Well That Ends Well. I played a beggar in Coriolanus. And I played Castizza in The Revenger's Tragedy.
This is pretty good, considering you had only been in the business a year or two.
Yes. One should beware of what you want, because it is actually what you get. And I did want very much to be a, you know, classical actress. I mean, the area of acting that I'd always found the most magical to me was not actually films or television. It was basically going to the early Royal Shakespeare and the early National Theatre productions.
Yes. Now, despite the fact that you were playing fairly serious parts in classical plays, you were being described in the press as Stratford's sex queen and a magnificent animal and the rest of it. This wasn't the usual way to greet a new recruit to the serious theatre.
No, I suppose that's why they did it, probably. They liked the contrast or the contradiction.
Yes.
It's a contradiction that I've not exactly encouraged, but I haven't not enjoyed. I like that contradiction. I think it's great.
Well, you did rather clinch matters by going off to play in a couple of films in which you had to take all your clothes
off. But everyone has to do that nowadays.
Yes, but I presume the producers were cashing in on your sexy publicity.
I don't think so. I don't think that sort of occurred to them, probably. I don't think they probably even read newspapers in that way.
Now, the following year, you played Lady Anne and Richard III and Ophelia, and you were offered the privilege already of being an associate artist of the Royal Shakespeare Company. What does that entail?
It was rather a one-sided relationship. It meant that, you know, you were supposed to give the Royal Shakespeare Company first call sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it didn't work out practically very well. It was a hangover from the days when people actually used to be paid, a sort of retainer.
Mm-hmm.
But that doesn't exist anymore. Yeah. That stopped an awfully long time ago.
Nevertheless, possibly a rather comforting feeling that there was some security about.
Well, the whole point of being an actress is to deny comfort in that sense and security. And so I always find it very discomforting and alarming, any suggestion of security. I feel claustrophobic about it and try and run as fast as I can in the opposite direction.
I'm sure that's the right attitude.
So I wasn't a natural associate member at all. I still am not.
What's your third record?
Well, it's just so wonderfully sad, this piece of music. It's the Adagio by Albinoni. It just makes me cry every time I hear it. It's wonderful.
The Adagio by Albinoni and Giazzotto, played by I Musici and Maria Teresa Garatti. How long was it, Helen, before you decided you ought to have a break from Shakespeare?
Well, it was about 4 years. I mean, it was a very useful 4 years because I didn't go to drama school. It was an absolutely wonderful experience to be in that kind of theatre, doing that sort of quality of work as a young actress. But I did start feeling I was on a sort of culture factory, you know, just churning out very good, you know, very laudable productions. But nonetheless, you know, every year this awful sort of regularity. And I started really questioning the whole basis of what theatre was, how it should be approached. I actually began thinking about it in a way other than just simply what sort of actress I was. So I asked a director called Peter Brook, I heard that he was starting an experimental theatre group, and I asked him if I could join his group, spend a year sort of just doing theatre research.
Mm-hmm. Where was he working in Paris, was he?
He was based in Paris then, yes.
Did you travel with it?
Yes, I spent a year. We went to Africa and to America.
What sort of productions?
Well, we didn't really do productions. We did improvisations in villages, to audiences which varied between literally three women and six goats was one of our audiences. And another audience was 2,000 tribesmen and women who were having some festival or other. So we played very, very varying audiences.
Mm. Did you learn a lot?
Yes, I did. I didn't feel at the time I'd learnt much, but perhaps those are your best lessons, the ones that dawn on you very, very slowly over the years, how much you've learnt. It seemed to be so very alien from the sort of work that I'd done before and that I came back to do subsequently. But in retrospect, actually, I learned an enormous amount from it.
How long did you stay with the group?
Just 1 year.
And then back to the RSC, the Royal Shakespeare Company?
No, back to all kinds of things then, television, you know, film.
And then you did a Ben Travers farce, which have been a nice contrast.
Yes, the best thing about the Ben, it was not a very good part I had to play in. So I didn't do it out of any sort of reasons of furthering my career at all. But the greatest pleasure was to meet the wonderful man who's sadly not with us anymore, called Ben Travers.
Ben Travers, a marvellous man.
An absolutely extraordinary man, one of the best people I've ever met in my life.
The Bed Before Yesterday.
That's right, yes.
And Teeth and Smiles, tell me about that. I don't know anything about Teeth and Smiles.
Well, that was a play that started at the Royal Court. It was a play about the rock and roll business. And it was actually the first play. When that was written, it was written by David Hare. No one had thought of writing plays about the rock and roll business. Now there's an awful lot of them. Mm. But it was before Rock Follies and all that. And it went down a bomb at the Royal Court. And the nicest thing was that we didn't get normal theatre audience. We got a lot of people from the music business, people who wouldn't normally go to the theatre at all. And it was absolutely packed out every night. And I played this sleazy rock and roll singer. In fact, The Rose, you know, the film with Bette Midler, was a very, very close copy, in fact, of this particular play.
So you did some rock singing?
Yes, I did. It was a nightmare because I can't sing, and it was an absolute nightmare. But I got through it. It was a bit rather like Dame Edith Evans, apparently, you know, the story of Dame Edith Evans going on to play one of those restoration beauties that everyone talks about how beautiful she is all the time. And sitting, and you know Dame Edith's not the prettiest of women, sitting looking in her mirror before she goes on saying, I am beautiful, I am beautiful, I am beautiful. And then walking on the stage with such a conviction of beauty that the audience perceive her as beautiful.
Yes.
Well, I used to do the same thing with my singing. And just make the audience believe I could sing by sheer force of my mental command over them.
With packed houses, rolling in the aisles.
Yes, at the court, and then we transferred it to the West End and it was empty. It just wasn't a West End play. It was funny.
Some say love, it is a river that drowns the tender reed. Some say love, it is a razor that leaves soul to bleed. Some say love, it is a hunger, an endless aching need. I say love, it is a
another record.
This is Dr. Brownie's famous cure I'd like next, Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee. This is a blast from the past for me because it was a record I heard in my very early days, about 14 or 15 I was, before I'd really heard any pop music or rock and roll music. And it was the first time I'd heard blues music, and it was like the most wonderful opening of a door into a whole new world. And it was just one of the most exciting sounds I'd ever heard. It's a pretty exciting record if you listen to the words.
You got bad blood, baby. I believe that you need a shot.
got bad blood, baby. I believe that you need a shot.
Dr. Brownie's famous cure by Sonny Terry and Brownie McGee. Back to the Royal Shakespeare Company, a part that must be very exciting to play as Queen Margaret and Henry VI, Part 1, 2, and 3.
I know, it is exciting. It sounds so boring, doesn't it? Henry VI, Part 1, 2, and 3.
Yes, he wasn't very good at titles with W. Shakespeare.
Oh, it's a real killer, isn't it? Mm. But it's a wonderful, extraordinary, mighty classical part.
Did you ever have to play the three parts in one day?
Yes. Oh, yes, we did that quite often, doing all the three plays together, which is a theatrical experience which always works.
Mm-hmm.
People love to come to the theatre at 10 in the morning and stay till 10 at night.
Yes.
They feel a sense of participation. It's funny, because it's how the ancient Greeks used to do it, of course, and it actually works.
It does work, because in the historical plays you recognise all these odd barons and people.
Yes.
You know who they are and you follow their careers through.
And by the end of the evening, the actors and the audiences, having been through such a sort of exhausting experience together, mm-hmm. you become like old friends. You have a real relationship with the audience at the end.
Thank you. You're now back with that first leading part you ever played, Cleopatra. How does it feel to tackle it again after so long, under such different circumstances?
Well, it's wonderful to have played it before. I mean, mainly because you actually remember the lines, which is an extraordinary miracle, especially someone like me who's totally forgetful.
Are you good
everything.
At learning?
I'm good at learning lines, yes. I learn them quickly. I forget them quickly as well. I mean, after you finish a play, within a week, you wouldn't be able to quote a line from it. I can never quote lines from plays. But they're somewhere in the back of your brain. And so when you just read the speech again, it comes back to you. And also, because you do have that sort of deep knowledge of the lines, it's difficult to explain, really, but you're not... It's a terrible disadvantage to be fighting for lines, and especially in Shakespeare, because your brain's having to move so fast on such a sort of complicated level in Shakespeare, to act in Shakespeare, that if you're having to worry about what line comes next, it is an extra burden.
Now, this production, which is currently in Stratford and is coming to London later, it's a studio production, a small-scale production.
Yes, it is.
How does that affect it?
You know, it's a play which is thought of in very epic terms, rather Cecil B. DeMille terms, always, and most of the productions. One can see why that is. It was, in fact, apparently written as a chamber play, and in fact, the scenes that are on the page are mostly just scenes between two people. They're quite small scenes. They're not huge epic scenes at all. You don't have any battle scenes. All the battle scenes are reported, people standing, watching the battle happen. At no point do soldiers come on stage at all.
Mm-hmm.
So it is actually written on a small scale.
One thinks of it as a big play.
As
but
a huge play.
Doesn't.
No, not in the way... However, that said, it's dealing with such epic matters, such as the losing of an empire, the making of an empire. And anyway, to have people on stage called Antony and Cleopatra. Michael Gambon and I wanted them to be called Geoffrey and Janet because somehow Antony and Cleopatra, you know, you've got such preconceived ideas. As soon as you say those names, you know, you have such massive sort of ideas, especially with Cleopatra. I don't think you can win with Cleopatra because everyone's got an idea of how she ought to look. Some people think she ought to have big bosoms, some think she ought to be thin, some people think she ought to be dark-haired, you know. Just everyone's got an idea of how their Cleopatra would be.
How much say did you have in what she ought to look like? I mean, was this a matter of mutual agreement?
No, it was a matter of sheer economy, because being at the other place, we have a budget of, I think, £2,000 for the whole thing, for the whole production.
Oh, no.
I mean, it is absolutely minute, and when critics, which they have done, criticise the set, we're simply using the set they use for Molière, because the Molière set was... We just didn't have enough money to make a set.
It amazes me that the Royal Shakespeare Company can get in debt for £400,000 and yet only put down £2,000 for a whole production.
Yes, but then other productions are massively expensive.
Yeah.
But the ideas about the other place is that it is always done on an extra... Mind you, people do break the rules. Some productions use a lot more money than they should. Mm-hmm. But we didn't. We kept very strictly within the rules of the budget.
And you're going to do The Roaring Girl by Decca.
Yes.
Is that going to be at the other place?
No, that'll be in the main house.
In the main house?
What we call the main house.
And that's coming to London too?
Yes, that'll be at the Barbican.
Have you started rehearsing that?
Not yet, any minute now, yes. With a director who likes a lot of improvising. I spent a whole year doing improvisations with Peter Brook, nothing but, and he still brings me out in a cold sweat. My palms go cold at the idea of improvising.
How much travelling have you done? I know you talked about playing in Africa and France with Peter Brook. You've played in Russia, haven't you?
Yes, I've played in Russia.
Do you speak any Russian?
No. I was very upset, actually. When I came back from Russia, my father told me that I've actually got relatives alive in Russia. And he didn't... That was quite early days, and you're on the cultural exchanges, and it was all a little bit tense. I don't know whether he didn't want to make their life more complicated than it need necessarily be. But I would have loved to have seen my relatives in Russia.
We've got now to record 5. What's that?
Yes, here we have a record which appeals to my Russian side of my nature, which is from the Russian liturgical choir, singing a beautiful chant.
Beatus Vir, sung by a male chamber choir conducted by Mikhail Milkov. Helen, you're a political person. You stood for the Equity Council a year or two ago.
I used to be political, sort of political. Now, I'm not really political at all, actually.
You stood as a member of the Revolutionary Workers' Party. Are you still a revolutionary worker?
No, I wasn't a member then. I never had been a member, but I stood on what they wanted to happen in equity, which at that time I agreed with.
Do you know?
I'm not quite sure what they want nowadays. I don't know. I mean, it was just rather a slightly rogue elephant sort of thing to do a bit. Because I noticed of all the things that most shocked my friends was any mention of the WRP. They just used to go into a complete fit, you know. I mean, it was like as if I was talking about joining the Moonies or... you know, becoming a fascist or something. It was very peculiar. They were really excessive in their reaction, and that rather brought out the devil in me and made me go...
Well, the party was advocating a communist state. It was a very extreme party.
Yes, oh, absolutely. Totally. I mean, I agree with extremes. There used to be a party in Italy which I would have joined called the Radical Party, and it said that it was the pepper in the arse of all the other parties. Just something to get everyone galvanised and angry.
But this really was a sense of mischief, of outrage.
Yes, I'm
to be outrageous.
Yes, I'm afraid it was, really.
classics.
I'm so ignorant about music, really. Opera, totally ignorant. I was just played this piece of music recently and I thought it was so extraordinary in terms of performance, sheer performance. I think that's why I've got this one, actually. As an actress, just recognising a piece of extraordinary acting performance. And perhaps it'll teach me a bit about opera. Anyway, it's Joan Sutherland singing the mad bit from Lucia di Lammermoor.
Joan Sutherland in Donizetti's Lucia di Lammermoor with the Paris Conservatoire Orchestra conducted by Nello Santi. And time is pressing, Helen. Let's go straight ahead into your next record.
Well, my next record is a piece of Indian classical music. I know very little about Indian classical music except that I love it whenever I hear it. So it's something that I could learn about on my island. This is a raga from South India.
Playing a South Indian raga. Are you a self-reliant person, Helen? Could you look after yourself on this island?
On an island, I could, yes. I find it difficult to look after myself in the modern world.
Mm-hmm.
But I love camping. Absolutely.
Did you ever
adore
do
camping.
Any... Were you a girl guide?
Oh, no, not in that organised way. I can't bear all that. That sort of military-type camping. But, I mean, when we went through Africa, we camped every night. And
yes.
I love making little huts out of bamboo and things like that.
Marvellous.
Making
your
little
ideal
hands at the bottom of the garden. I'm an ideal castaway.
Yes, indeed you
Absolutely.
Are.
Absolutely.
What about food? You can forage for food?
I'll forage away like anything, yes, and plant things, I'll garden.
Done any fishing?
Fishing, I have done fishing with very, very little success, but I don't mind fishing. It's one of the few sports,
mm-hmm.
blood sports, and it is a blood sport, which I can actually bear.
And you've done some sailing, I believe.
Yes, I used to sail at home. I never really enjoyed it too much, so I don't think I'll be constructing myself a little boat.
All right, just
to get away on.
Stay there and we'll try and come and fetch you as soon as we can.
Yes. Thank you.
record number 8 is what?
Record number 8 is Billie Holiday singing Falling in Love Again. For two reasons. One is Billie Holiday, one of my favourite singers. And the other is the song Falling in Love Again, which is really, that's kind of been the main guiding force in my life to this point, I would say.
Men flock around me like moths around the flame. And if their wings burn, I know I'm not to blame. Falling in love again, never wanted to. What am I to do? Gee, I can't help it.
Billie Holiday. If you could take only one disc, which would it be?
I just completely changed my mind. I was going to say the Indian music, because it'd be good education for me, but I think I'm going to take Pass the Duchy.
Right. Pass the Duchy. Yes. And one luxury, one thing you would like to have on the island that's of no practical use.
No practical use.
No.
Oh, so I can't have the QE2, for example.
Oh, no.
Without the sailors. Just the QE2.
No, much too practical. No. You'd learn how to sail it yourself.
Well, in that case, it's a tight battle between a jar of Marmite and an incredibly expensive set of silk underwear. I think I'll take the silk underwear.
The silk underwear. We'll give you two sets.
The best.
One for Sundays.
But the best, the most expensive.
Of course. And one book, the Bible and Shakespeare, are provided.
Yes. The book I take, again, is Education. And it's a book called the Bhagavad Gita. I hope I've pronounced it right.
Yes, an
ancient Indian book of knowledge.
A book of philosophy.
Yes. Hard going. I keep trying to read it. I can't understand a word.
Bhagavad Gita.
Yes.
Thank you, Helen Mirren, for letting us hear your Desert Island Disc.
Thank you very much for the pleasure.
Goodbye, everyone.